In his heyday, Sylvester Junkyard Dog Ritter was so popular with the fans that he could give Hulk Hogan a run for his money. But thanks to a multitude of unfortunate twists and turns, he never quite reached his full potential. Here's the tragic, real-life story of Junkyard Dog. Junkyard Dog was a talented performer with a natural charisma that could arguably match most performers of his era. So it can seem strange that his time with the WWF, now known as WWE, wasn't more stellar. As Bleacher Report notes, the wrestler was easily the biggest star in Mid-South wrestling, and even when he moved to the WWF, the audience would often go nuts whenever he appeared. In wrestling terms, he was over with the fans. Wrestling Observer reported that he could even outshine an all-time great like Ric Flair. Wrestler Buddy Landell said, "I've never seen anyone who was over like Junkyard Dog in his prime. I was never around Hogan in his prime, but I was around Ric Flair in his peak, and he was never over like JYD." But the WWF never quite capitalized on Junkyard Dog's popularity with the fans. Though his tenure with the company involved some high-profile opportunities, including tag team bouts with Hogan himself, he was generally treated as a mid-level talent. His profile on WWE.com confirms he never won a single WWF championship. While JYD was eventually inducted into the WWE Hall of Fame, his actual time with the company seems to have largely ignored his potential as a top star.
I got the people in the wrestling ring, I got the people outside the wrestling ring cheering me on, I got the people in the crowd when I'm singing cheering me on, so we're all going to do it together.
Junkyard Dog was a charismatic guy, but that didn't make him exempt from the casual, sometimes cruel racism that pervaded pro wrestling. In the WWF, commentator Jesse the Body Ventura referred to his popular post-victory dance as a lot of shucking and jiving, and claimed that his speech sounded like he had, quote, a mouthful of grits. Even his super popular stint with Mid-South Wrestling was somewhat marred by racism. As Deadspin points out, Junkyard Dog's opponents often used racist invective against him, and what's more, he didn't choose the chains he wore as his gimmick. Wrestling promoter Bill Watts came up with the idea. Fortunately, Junkyard Dog was often able to be the hero. Since he was almost always the babyface or good guy of the feud, and his opponents were often rather openly racist against him, he was often presented as a heroic figure fighting against racial injustice, and the crowd was cheering him. During his days in the Mid-South, Junkyard Dog was a beloved hero who used Queen's Another One Bites the Dust as his entrance music. He was almost too beloved. One of his stranger feuds at the time involved his enemies, the Fabulous Freebirds, blinding Junkyard Dog with hair cream. This coincided with the real-life birth of his daughter, and the prospect of the heroic wrestler not being able to see the baby got the crowds very, very mad. The Freebirds soon needed police protection. Wrestling Observer noted that the story almost ended in a disaster when the blind Junkyard Dog took the ring to address his adoring audiences, some of whom were apparently convinced that he had actually lost his sight and had to leave the business for good. When the Freebirds inevitably entered the ring to gang up on the helpless Junkyard Dog, one fan actually entered the fray and pointed a gun at one of them. Fortunately, no one was shot. Security overpowered the gun-toting fan and took him away. Substance abuse was a notorious problem for many wrestling stars of Junkyard Dog's era, and he was no exception. The wrestling movement reports his struggle with addiction started in the 1980s, when he operated with the aid of cocaine, among other drugs, which you could occasionally hear during some of his more energetic promos. The Wrestling Observer notes that Junkyard Dog soon developed a cocaine habit that caused him to neglect training. His promoter at the time, Bill Watts, tried to protect his top performer, whose wrestling ability was rapidly declining, and whose significant weight gain soon destroyed his once impressive physique. It was clear that Junkyard Dog had problems that went way beyond his in-ring prowess. Perhaps the best description of Junkyard Dog's relationship to drugs comes from the Iron Sheik, a fellow wrestling legend who has also faced down problems with addiction, and who, according to Maxim, got his first taste of crack courtesy of Junkyard Dog. The Sheik said of JYD, "He my friend, but he no perfect." Junkyard Dog's lifestyle started to take a toll on his body. According to the wrestling movement, his cocaine and alcohol use were weighing him down, both in the ring and out. As Wrestling Observer notes, his increasing sloppiness severely hurt his popularity at Mid-South Wrestling, and though the WWF eventually brought him to bigger and more visible arenas, JYD's personal struggles continued. He also developed a propensity for unhealthy eating, which earned him the unsavory nickname Junk Food Dog. Junkyard Dog's professionalism started to creak under his many excesses. He started skipping scheduled appearances, and though the WWF gave him some leeway, the company ultimately decided to let him go. In 1988, Junkyard Dog returned to the NWA, which soon became WWF rival promotion WCW. But both his star power and performances were disappointing, and he left in 1991 for the independent circuit. JYD was more or less aware of his situation, though he was never able to get fully clean. In his later years, he was quite open about his addictions and the toll they had taken on him. His friend Ted DiBiase, known to WWF fans as the Million Dollar Man, revealed that shortly before Junkyard Dog died, he gave DiBiase permission to use him as an example to steer kids toward better life choices. Junkyard Dog's two marriages went so badly that one of them involved a kidnapping and a gunshot. The details of his first divorce are somewhat unclear, but his arduous travel schedule seems to have played a large part. After the split, his ex-wife spent some time at a mental institution, after which she kidnapped their daughter from Junkyard Dog's parents' house. On his quest to find his daughter, the wrestler soon burst through the door of his former brother-in-law's house, and the ensuing confrontation ended with his ex-wife's brother, a police officer, taking an accidental gunshot. The end of Junkyard Dog's second marriage didn't involve quite as much drama, but it was devastating to his finances. He reportedly lost pretty much all his earthly possessions, including his car and home. Every pro wrestler hangs up their boots eventually, but Junkyard Dog's retirement years were more tragic than most. According to the wrestling movement, he didn't have much to show for his wildly popular wrestling career in his later years. He spent much of his post-wrestling time doing odd jobs with no permanent home. Junkyard Dog clung to wrestling as long as he could, pleading in vain for chances from his former promoters and appearing in occasional independent shows to the point that his declining in-ring ability allowed. This may have been a money thing, but according to sportscasting, his sheer love for the job seems to have been a significant factor too. Promoter Guy Walters explained, "He retired in 1988, and 10 years later, he was still in the ring. He had a hard time giving it up. He enjoyed it all, the big crowds, the small. It didn't make any difference as long as he was around to sign autographs and take Polaroids with the kids." Walters also revealed that Junkyard Dog made sure to tell those kids to make better life choices than he had. Walters said of JYD, "Every kid he'd meet, he'd say, 'Are you still in school? Stay there, baby. Do it.'"
If I had to pick my faves, I'd go with The Undertaker or Junkyard Dog. How about you?
The final tragedy in Junkyard Dog's life came in the summer of 1998, was twofold, and happened over a single weekend. As Wrestling Observer reported, he made an attempt to attend the high school graduation of his daughter, only to find out that he'd arrived too late and she had already gone to celebrate with her friends. He never saw his daughter again. The following morning, Junkyard Dog started his journey back, but he never made it. As he was driving on Interstate 20, Sylvester Junkyard Dog Ritter died in a single car accident that sent his vehicle rolling 3 times. He was 45 years old. 5 days later, the pro wrestling star was buried in Wadesboro, North Carolina. Apart from his former comrade Buddy Landell, the professional wrestlers he'd worked with all his life were largely absent from the ceremony, though some sent flowers. However, the Junkyard Dog's impact was still clear, as the crowd that attended the funeral was up to 2,000 strong. Michael Jordan, a North Carolina native and fan, reportedly reached out with his condolences. Junkyard Dog's daughter, LaToya Ritter, was instrumental in many dramatic turns of her father's life. According to Wrestling Observer, her father's inability to see her was a major part of the infamous blindness storyline during Junkyard Dog's Mid-South days. Ritter's graduation weekend in 1998 also ended with her father's fatal car accident. She was also the one who represented her dad when he was inducted into the WWE Hall of Fame in 2004. Unfortunately, like her father, Ritter also passed away at an early age. On October 19, 2011, she was talking on the phone when she had a sudden heart attack at just 31 years old. A family friend said, "Doctors said she was gone before she hit the floor. As tragic as her loss is, there's consolation in the knowledge that she didn't suffer." If you or someone you know is struggling with addiction, please call the Substance Abuse and Mental Health Administration's 24/7 National Helpline at 1-800-662-HELP. That's 1-800-662-4357.